Great. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our last speaker for Genetic Genealogy Ireland 14. And Gerard Corcoran is the regional director for ISOG, the International Society of Genetic Genealogy, in Ireland. He's done great work being an advocate for genetic genealogy with the Irish government and has made various presentations to departmental ministers, some of whom we're going to meet on Monday in the Dáil. So he is a wonderful representative for our community here in Ireland, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to him, introduce him to you even. He is a member of ISOG, the Genealogical Society of Ireland, and the Global Diaspora Forum. For his day job, he's a senior solutions manager for Huawei Technologies, internet and telecommunications industry. And he is indeed a genetic genealogy evangelist. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome Gerard Corcoran.
Thank you, Maurice. I believe we're running a little bit late, so I don't want you all late for your dinner. So I'll go through some of the slides quickly, leave a little bit of time for discussion afterwards. And so the topic I'll be addressing, a quick overview of what we're doing in ISOG here in Ireland, the comparison of the direct-to-consumer testing, the different value propositions have. The main focus will be on migrations. Migrations both into Ireland in ancient times and then out of Ireland in more recent times. A look at where bioinformatics is, because this is a big issue with us now. We have a lot of data being generated, so how do we analyze this data? Next generating sequencing, connecting our global diaspora. We'll have a look at two case studies and then a few concluding remarks. All of this information is online on my Pinterest board. I've got about 6,000 research topics up there, or links to direct research papers which are used in this analysis. So you can get back to the original research papers by just clicking on a link on the Pinterest board. There are over 100 boards up there. The first 50 are mainly dealing with the background historical context, historical, linguistic, archaeological context. And the following 50 ones are more technical in nature, and it tends to be a lot of mapping results, geographic locations, actual analysis of the SNPs themselves, frequency of SNPs in Ireland. Yeah, so the first part is historical in context, the second part is a bit more technical and a bit more orientated DNA. So what have we been doing in Ireland? Of course, thanks to Maurice, we have this very successful Genetic Genealogy Ireland last year, and again, growing from strength to strength this year, with an amazing lineup of speakers. We also do several lectures around Ireland. I did some in Trinity College and in the National Library, in some of the universities, talked to the testing companies, usually clan gatherings and things like that. I know Maurice has been up to Northern Ireland. We both did one in the Burr Historical Society at Burr Vintage Week this year. Tyrone has also done several talks around Ireland. We've also been involved in our Ireland Reaching Out, which is a community-led effort, a bottom-up effort to reach out to our diaspora. That is organized in every parish in Ireland. Ultimately, I think they will organize in 3,600 parishes in Ireland. They have volunteers from each parish. They've also, I started a DNA project there where we would look to identify the most local person in the parish and offer them a kit to test. And that was done with the 23andMe company at the time. There was also, of course, we heard from Dr. Wells yesterday, the genographic project in Ireland, which they tested 100 people, including our Taoiseach and the Kenny. And we saw Enda's results yesterday. Not typical of the Irish profile, because 6% of people in Ireland would typically have a Gaelic type of sort of genetic signature. The Mayo project was fascinating in that they found a very, very high percentage of M222, the highest in the country. They found 32 additional markers below M222, which gives a lot more detail. They found a lot of diversity in the types of M22 markers, which would indicate that it's a very old location for this particular marker, and it would also maybe indicate that it could have originated there, but there's an awful lot of debate about that. And of course, we hear today about the People of the British Isles project, and this is a fascinating project. I think the first time today I saw that level of detail in the People of the British Isles, and this will help enormously in future matching and doing ancestry analysis for people. We're also tracking, I'm also a member of the Irish DNA Atlas. I've submitted my own sample there, and hopefully, I think last I counted, they had 150 samples.
150,
so they probably need an awful lot more, and I understand that results may take another year or two before the results of that project come out. And Tyrone talked about his analysis, which was based on the Irish origins and Scottish origins, which we saw earlier today. And of course, last year was the Year of the Gathering, where the government organized localities, villages, clans, people, families to invite people back. I organized one of my own gatherings, and I did some DNA lectures at some of the other gatherings which were going on last year. So, which tests? I've actually tested with all of the main testing companies. We talk about the big four, and the big four are ftDNA, 23andMe, Genographic, and Ancestry, of course, right? And of course, there are two others, which is Ireland's, Britain's DNA, and Full Genomes, which is a very small company, but they do very high density tests for white chromosome testing. And this is basically an overview of what they do. They do paternal, maternal, autosomal. 23andMe is the only one that does health, but they've run into trouble with the FDA with that, so they've had to suspend the health analysis. They still provide the health markers. And then there's a whole new series of tests called the pre-NGS tests and the post-NGS tests. NGS is next generation sequencing. Basically, it's not a predefined chip where you're looking for specific markers, but it scans across the entire genome and it picks up any new markers which may be unique to yourself. So it's a very, very powerful evolution in the technology. And the two companies which do that at the moment are ftDNA with Big Y and NGS with Y Elite, it's called, or it's called Y Full sometimes. This is an example of my own particular results. So my very first test in 2005 was the Geno 150, and we're back here at M269, and that would have been, that was a 12 marker test. And we were talking about the original studies which were done, for example, the Bradley and the McAvoy studies were done using this type of technology, or generally from 12 to 17 markers, right? But then Geno brought out the Geno 2.0, which had 150,000 ancestry informative markers available. And that brought us down to this level here, in my case, down to the F21, which we think was somewhere between the Bronze Age and the Iron Age, right? The ftDNA had their STR markers, 23andMe. Although they sampled a million SNPs, this was mainly for medical or health informative reasons, and their ancestry, particularly the paternal side, was quite weak, and it's still based on the 2010 ISUB tree. And then we get into Britain's DNA is here, and again that brings me down to about DF21. And then suddenly this year everything changes. We have the SNP tsunami, as it's called, where a deluge of data, and we get the big Y and the FGC test, and this one shows the coverage of FGC, and this one here shows the coverage of big Y in this case. So these SNPs here will bring it down to pretty much the last 100, 150 years, right? So I generally use accounts of 100 years per SNP. Some other people use somewhere between 100 and 150 years per SNP. Okay. So, and this one here is one of my matches on the big Y. It's called Rowan. And we can pinpoint where that match probably occurred, before names were actually adopted. We think it's the 6th century, and there are lots of circumstantial reasons to assume the connection between the name Rowan and the name Corcoran has a similar origin and a similar geographic origin also. So that's a quick analysis of the different types of tests. The good news is that for the we're talking about Y tests here, is that it brings us down into the historical and the genealogical period. And as Dr. Wells mentioned yesterday, 2013 was a year of inflection. It took us 10 years to get to 1 million people tested. And then 2014, an additional 1 million people. And most likely for next year, it'll be an additional 1 million people, if not more. So we are really on the upward curve in terms of numbers of people tested. And this is good news because it means more matches. It means a lot more data to do analytics. 2014, I mentioned, was the year of the SNP tsunami. In 2005, we had about 60 branches on the phylogenetic tree, and then gradually it increased over time, and then suddenly, because of the NGS testing, it took off here. So last year we had 4,000 branches on the tree. This year we have over 14,000 branches on the tree, and this is only a tiny part of the newly discovered SNPs which have been discovered. So the team in ISOG, Alice Fairhurst, is very, very busy. They have very strict criteria for getting a SNP onto a branch. It has to be double tested. You have to have at least two people. It has to be Sanger sequenced as well. So you have an additional quality check. And we will expect that to, actually there wouldn't be enough space on the chart to show that particular graph. So the message is that we are at a period of inflection, a very, very high rate of change, which is very good for genetic genealogists because we have more data. The bad news is how do we analyze that data? And I'll just show, because I've tested with all these, what my particular results were, so we're actually doing an apples-to-apples comparison. Ancestry, the main strong point about Ancestry, of course, is they have so many trees online, right? They have 50 million trees, 5 billion profiles online, and so on and so forth. The unfortunate thing is that they've withdrawn from the Y testing business so far. They did have a Y tests and now they have withdrawn from that. They do have a good autosomal test, and I was very surprised to hear today that they'll be integrating the people of the British Isles data.
In discussion.
So that's an interesting scoop, I would say.
Yeah.
So But my autosomal test, it shows that, you know, basically it pinpoints me to the Isles, basically. And my I know from my Y marker also, the DF21, it's very much an Isles space marker. And FTD and A have the broadest range of tests from Y, MTD and A. Oh, excuse me.
Lost your microphone.
Okay.
The batteries went.
Battery?
Yeah. Okay. Change it. But that one should be working. Now.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fine. So FTD and A have the broadest range of products from Y, MTD and A, autosomal, now the big Y. And the latest news from last week's conference is that they will have a deep clade, a new deep clade test, so that if you are, for example, M222, they will offer, I don't know, up to 50 SNPs below M222, all for an average price, I think, of $1 or $2 per SNP. Whereas today, the a la carte price of a SNP is about $39. So it'll be a big improvement in the type of tests. And they also provide certificates, which the other companies generally don't provide. And these can be framed and hung on your wall along with your other. Great, thank you. And in terms of SNPs, they provide SNP match, so no surprise. Mine are mainly located on the Isles here, and also where some of my ancestors, diaspora, where they emigrated to the States, they tended to settle in these locations here. And for FTDNA, my ancestry, similar to the ancestry.com one, slightly to the east. I don't necessarily agree with that. Doesn't correspond to my known ancestry. So I think for once the ancestry product got it better, and if you like, better accuracy. And of course, they have an ever increasing number of tests. The really strong point about the FTDNA value proposition is the project organization system, the surname projects, the SNP projects, the marker projects, the geographic projects, and all of the help that the citizen scientists and the volunteers provide for those. Genographic was, of course, the first to start this industry going in 2005 with Geno 1.0. We heard from Dr. Wells yesterday. They have Geno 2.0. They got my maternal line H1C1 and DF21 correct, and it brought it down to a pretty good level. But as we know, with the next generation tests, it goes about 60 levels below that now. So I understand that Morris asked a question yesterday, and I understand they're preparing a Geno 3.0, which would be a more advanced chip. And these are the types of migration maps they give. Pretty much all of these migration maps are the same. They show Adam or Eve coming out of Africa about 200,000 years ago, crossing into Siberia, going into Eurasian continent, and then coming back west into Europe, maybe going over to Iberia, maybe going up the river networks into Europe. And 23andMe, they had a lot of problems with the FDA last year, and they've had to back away from the healthcare analysis, but their ancestry DNA relatives one is pretty good. And here I see I have 800 matches, and fourth cousins, second cousins, and close. And this is the type of analysis they give. Very, very good mapping results, very good maps of where my matches are, and also a list of names available on both sides. And it also gives an ancestry component, so nearly 100% Northern European. Then Britain's DNA is slightly different. They have a much smaller database. They also use a different naming convention. They don't use the ISOG tree naming convention, so it can be a bit confusing comparing like with like. And I would say it's about equivalent to the Geno 2.0. In my case, it found the same amount of data. It positioned me at DF21. It positioned me at H1C1 for maternal. And is this the type of analysis they provide? I like this particular one, which is a frequency table of all of the particular helper groups which you match. And this is the same for mtDNA. So they're quite good in the graphics department and probably do a little bit nicer analysis than some of the other companies. And they also do raw data analysis where you can get all of your individual SNPs, which you're positive for here. And finally, this is YFull, which is a post-testing analysis of the FGC product. One interesting thing here is the STR results. I got 444 STRs, whereas on ftDNA, the maximum is 111. At the moment. So, and of course, the main part of the product is the SNPs analysis. So I get, they test 52,000 and I'm positive for 1,971 and about 60 novel SNPs, below what I currently understood, to be my terminal SNP. So we have a quick look at migrations. Again, all of this stuff is online. Firstly, a lot of recommended books. There are about 100 recommended books in there which deal with the subject, either from the leading authors, Cunliffe, Koch, or Mallory, or Jean Manco, or anything which is relevant to the subject, it's listed in here. Also, very interesting documentaries, for instance, on Cromwell or on the migration periods in Ireland. The Irish Ice Age, when Ireland was connected to Britain, and Britain was connected via Dodderland to Europe, and people walked over the land bridges to populate the country. The post-glacial era, the Mesolithic period, where we find all of the settlements up in Antrim or down on the Shannon or down in Kerry. Indo-European, because we are an Indo-European people, Celtic or Gaelic is and English, of course, are Indo-European languages. What was the migration of the Indo-European people in Europe? The Neolithic age, the invention of farming created a massive expansion in population and also in the phylogenetic tree. We can see that on the phylogenetic tree, where the branches go from stubby little branches to big bushes. You can see by looking at the tree where the population explosions happen. And we can see that they happened in Europe, which was the largest one, and that was R1B. We can see that it happened in China, I believe it's old, and that was related to the Han. The invention of agriculture in China and the expansion of the Han people. And we can see it in Africa much later, it was with the Bantu people and the expansion of the Bantu people. And that's the helper group E. And Irish Bronze Age period, which was sort of a golden age. This was when many of the migrations into the country happened. The Celtic migrations, so on and so forth, analysis of DNA, and then into the Iron Age, early Christian period. There was a period when there was a lot of monastic movement in Ireland, sort of golden age in Ireland, with the construction of monasteries and writing and manuscripts. And that was exported to the European continent, particularly down the Rhine Valley. And there are many monastic settlements which are still present. I visited about 50 of them in Germany last year. And medieval period, there was a period when we have a relatively rich written genealogies. We have a huge corpus of ancient genealogies which were written down. Some of them, of course, are suspect. Some are real. So we have to determine which parts of them are fake and which parts of them are real. And that's a big challenge, but it's also a big opportunity. Of course, we had the Viking migrations from the 8th century onwards, the Irish-Norman migrations from the 12th century onwards, the Anglo-Saxon migrations, which originally came from Britain, and then later in the Tudor, Elizabethan, Cromwellian, Williamite periods moved into Ireland. Migrations out, people left the country after the Battle of Ockram or the Battle of the Boyne or the Siege of Limerick. There was a flight of the Earls. Very large numbers of people went out, joined the European regiments. These were called the Wild Geese. And a particular interest of mine is the Wine Geese. And these were the people who joined the European armies, were awarded estates in Bordeaux for their service, and now probably 20 of the great chateaux of Bordeaux have Irish names on them, like Lynchbash or Kirwan or O'Brien. Haute-Brion is actually O'Brien, and there are many other chateaux like that. The Irish Scottish migration, very important. This happened earlier than the great famine migrations from Ireland. Well, the Scots, so-called Scots-Irish migrations to the US. We also had the Huguenot and Palatines came in during the 17th and 18th century. And of course, the 18th century was the Georgian period, 19th century Victorian period, which also coincided with the Great Famine in Ireland and the diaspora in the US, which actually resulted from those migrations out. Many of them joined Irish regiments in the US, including some of my DNA matches, and they joined the Civil War. Maybe they went over impoverished. They were signed up to the Civil War. They were on the winning side. They were granted lands by Lincoln or his successor, and they settled down as farmers up in Minnesota. And that was a particular case for mine. And some, of course, made good, like the Kennedys. And there are many other success stories after several generations. So, and then after that, I go into more of mapping of all of these results, and then detailed analysis of the SNPs. So look at my particular defining markers, which would be representative, I think, of 66% of Irish people. 66% of us have the L21 marker, which is sometimes called the Italo-Celtic marker. And if you go back far enough, you come to R1B. But there is a very important one, which is not R1B, which is G. And this corresponded to the early Neolithic, or the expansion of agriculture out of Anatolia, along the Mediterranean with Cardium ware. And so Otzi the Iceman, who was sampled for his DNA, he turns out to be G. So he's representative of this initial movement out of Anatolia. And the closest match to Otzi today would be the people of Sardinia. And that could have been responsible for the megalithic movement in Europe. There is some discussion about that at the moment, whether that represented the people who built the megalithics, particularly on the European Western seaboard, and also into Ireland. The most recent full genome sequencing studies and population migration is probably represented here. Basically, the idea is that there are three main defining populations for Europe. 145,000 years ago, which would have been the early hunter-gatherers, right? And maybe you see traces of that in places like Göbekli Tepe in Anatolia or some of the great places like that. And that was the early population of Europe. And I believe it would correspond to the marker I or J or some of those. And later, 7,000 years, this is called the East European Farmers, EEF. And that would correspond to the Neolithic Revolution. And recently, they discovered the third very important one. And it was after testing the Altai boy in Siberia. And this corresponds to a later period, and a post-Neolithic period. And it seems to be coming from Siberia through the steppes into Europe. And of course, these migrations were not like lemmings. They weren't going in one direction. There were back migrations. There were so-called reflux migrations. And so we had the hunter-gatherers, the South European farmers, and then this ancient Eurasian mark. If you look at the Y side, that previous one was looking at full genome autosomal analysis. Now we look at the Y. The most important marker in Europe is R, O1B. Its highest percentage is in Europe. Its highest percentage in Europe is in Western Europe. Its highest percentage in Western Europe is in the Isles. Its highest percentage in the Isles is in Ireland. Its highest percentage in Ireland is in the west of Ireland. Now, for this particular one, R1A, yes, which is a subclade of R, R1A corresponds to Eastern European or Slavic. Okay, so most Slavic populations would have the R1A marker. This is the R1B, and this is the Western European component of R. And again, the highest percentage is in Ireland and in the west of Ireland. So, if you like, we contain a reflection, I suppose, of some of the oldest DNA of what populated Europe 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 years ago. And this one, that corresponds to about 2005 and the level of testing of Y DNA markers. In 2005, my marker told I was M269, which was the classical Western European marker. And Mike Hammer has, I believe he showed this one, where it originated either north or south of the Black Sea. It developed into L23 around the Balkans. And then later on, a marker developed, which was L51, which was closer to the Alps or the center of Europe. And then that became L11, and then suddenly everything went crazy, massive expansion, and this, we believe, was associated with the age of metals or the invention of tools and chariots, horse-drawn chariots, and so on and so forth. And that expanded again into two major clades. One was what we call the P312, which is called the Italo-Celtic marker, And the other one was the Germanic marker, which was U106. It's called the Germanic marker here. So effectively, you have Western Europe divided between Celtic on the west and Germanic on the east. And the most extreme expansions in all of R1B was under P312. And there are three main markers. L21, which is the classic one for the Isles, and in particular Ireland. 66% of people in Ireland are L21. DF21, DF27, an extreme expansion in Iberia. This is the brother clade of L21. And further east was U152. And this was now Pandemarca. And we'll have a closer look at those again. So we have a look at L23. This was the Balkans. And we think this is where the Anatolian farmers met the Bronze Age warriors from the steppes. And this was a melting. We know that early Bronze Age and development happened here in the Tagus Valley, and in particular in a place called Huebla or Rio Tinto, which is still known for copper today as a mining company. And the other great big copper producing areas was in the Balkans. And then after L23, we have L51. And this is, if you wanted to pick the ideal place to populate Europe, you'd probably pick this place. It's at the head of all of the great rivers. It's where all of the great rivers come together. You have the Danube, the Rhine, the Loire, the Rhone. All of the great rivers of Western Europe originate up there in the Alps, and this is where this particular marker expanded. P312, the Italo-Celtic one, and you can see a very high percentage in Ireland, but also strong along the Western European seaboard. L21, this is the Irish one, this is my marker, this is the marker of 66% of Irish people, very heavily concentrated in the Isles and Ireland. DF27, this is the Iberian marker, and it's the brother clade of L21, and we also find it mainly in Iberia, but also up here. Interestingly, the National Geographic did two projects, one in Mayo and one in Asturias. The Mayo results show the highest percentage of L21 in Ireland, and that was mainly M222. The Asturias one showed a very high percentage of DF27. So again, confirming what all of the academic papers have been telling us up to now, what all of the hobbyist testing data sets. Remember, we have, for our data sets for L21, we have about 12,000 samples available for analysis. So it gives us very granular detail on where these have high frequencies. So I just, because we have this notion that there are Celtic lands around the Western seaboard, I said, what would it look like to map L21 and DF27 together? And you get something like that, which is very much an Atlantic seaboard. These are the traditional Celtic language countries here. And these are these two markers. And this is the European construct of the Arc Atlantic. U152 is slightly different. It's and this could correspond. We think this is a Bronze Age Atlantic Europe type of migration. Whereas this one is definitely more of the historic, what we know about the Celts, and the Hallstatt Celts and Lateni Celts, and that would seem to correspond more to this particular marker, which is U152. U106, as I mentioned, is the German marker, and it's related to these areas. It also corresponds to the Anglo-Saxon marker, so that when we saw the people of the British Isles earlier today, all of that red, that would correspond to basically the that particular marker. And what could explain things? There's an awful lot of discussion. Nothing has been settled. Everyone has their own opinion on this. There's one particular author, Jean Manco, who tends to be quite up to date on the latest DNA sampling and also on the historical research. And her opinion is that it corresponds to the Belbeker movement. We know that the original Belbeker culture emerged out of Lisbon or the Iberia, and then migrated east. But then there was a reflux and also a reoccupation of this area. And the DNA evidence is also telling us this, that there was this massive expansion of DF27, which was the most extreme expansion of all of the particular markers which we have. And that this could correspond to an Atlantic Age type, to a Bronze Age type settlement. And as Jean's particular idea on this is that the archaeological record is in the warrior stelae, which they have left a trail of them, of these warrior stelae, from Scythia, or the Kurgan area, the Yamna tribes, right across through the Alpine area into Iberia. Around here, John Koch is doing a lot of research transcribing all of these stelae, and his latest theory is that this was original Celtic writing now. And this is Tartessos, these are the Tartessos stelae. So there's a lot of research ongoing, probably too early to make a call on it, but certainly very, very interesting developments. This is a map I put together myself based on what our understanding of those different markers are and where their frequencies are. And we have, this is the ancient marker which came from the east. This is the European hunter-gatherers, the East European farmers. On the Y side, we have M269, L23, L51. And then everything focused around L11, the extreme expansion of P312, and then we go up into Ireland, L21, high percentage in Brittany, and then under L21, DF13, and all of the other markers under L21, like the DF21, which is my own marker, M222, which is the Isle of Nine Hostages marker. Okay, a lot of research, as I said, done by the archaeologists and the linguists, working hand in hand for once with the geneticists. And this work from Professor Koch and Cunliffe. I think Dan Bradley has been involved in some of it. But mainly it's the team from the ancient DNA subtly labs in Germany, in Mainz, and so on and so forth. So, so we have arrived in Ireland, and eventually we start writing stuff down, and I think people had folk memory of genealogy, but then they also had real genealogies which they wrote down, and these are documented in, I've identified about 100 of them. Bart Jasko wrote a very interesting book on medieval kinship, and for each of these genealogies there are probably 50 to 100 names in them. So we have 5,000 to 10,000 named individuals in ancient times that we can potentially map to. So that's the big challenge. A lot of work. It shouldn't be done by geneticists. It should be done by historians. But if this historians don't step up to it, we'll have to do it ourselves. But anyhow. So quick look at the migrations into Ireland. 8,000 BC, early settlers. Celtic, they say 500 BC, but it was probably earlier. If you want to look at Proto-Celtic or Pre-Proto-Celtic or Bellbeaker, it's almost certainly earlier. These are the Viking migrations with all the settlements on the east coast. The Norman migrations and I think Dr. Tyrone Bowes covered that earlier today, with the building out of all the castles. And there was expansion of the Normans and also retraction of the Normans when the Gaelic revival happened in medieval times. Anglo-Irish around the Pale. And then the different plantations of the establishment of the earldoms of Ormond and Desmond, Wexford. And we can see all of the genetic traces of these movements. The English and Scots with the Ulster plantation, the King's County and Queen's County plantations, and the Munster plantations. Gallowglass, Huguenot, Palatine, Jewish, Spanish, European, and then into modern times with the modern settlers in Ireland. And as I mentioned earlier, L21 is the defining marker for Ireland. It's 66%. So excuse me if I just focus on this one for the rest of the analysis. It corresponds to about 66% of people in Ireland. We have DF20. 49 is the big one. This is the 989 hostages. M222 is part of that. I'm in DF21, which corresponds to, we say, the three colours, or Eli O'Carroll, or the, somewhere around the Midlands. Z235, I know Finbar's in the room, so I'd better mention C4466, which is the Munster marker. And that corresponds to the O'Donoghues and the O'Sullivans and all of those great names of Munster. And Finbar is the project administrator along with Elizabeth and someone else. Yeah. And if we plot these, we can start to have a look at where we find the highest frequencies. This is not the latest map. I'll try to update the latest map, but definitely DF49, that's Northwest Irish, and that's a very high concentration in Mayo, but also in Donegal and Derry, and we had several speakers talk about that earlier. DF21, which is my one, which is concentrated in Midlands, but many of the diaspora community testing probably emigrated from Galway, and so that's been reflected in the frequency matches. These are not exact scientific studies. These are based on hobbyist testing. We have 12,000 samples in the data sets, so they're good representative samples, but they are not bias-free samples, and that has to be remembered. 4466 is Munster. Corresponds to the O'Sullivans, the O'Donoghues, many of the great names of Munster. The DF253, this is the so-called L226, or the O'Brien one, or Brian Beru, or the Dalcash, they say. And what surprised us in analyzing all of this data is the amount of overlap with Scotland. There is huge overlap, especially between DF49, which some say is associated with the Dalrida, with DF21, which is my marker, also a very heavy Scottish overlap. And we can see in the historical period, the Norse Gaels, the Scots, which are really the Dalrida or the Gaels down here, with the Picts and the Norse and the Angles. Now, there are many sources of Irish genealogy. One of them I have at home is a book. It's about this size in five volumes with about 10,000 individuals named, I believe. And this was written by the Dubtach MacFirbach in the 17th century, and it was translated by Nulligo O'Marola, Professor Nulligo O'Marola. And this is a great source for ancient genealogies. Unfortunately, it's not digitized or indexed or scanned. All of the original manuscripts have been digitized, and they are available on the UCD site, so you could link to the original manuscript written in Gaelic for these. And of course, there are many others. There are about 20 other great works like these, like the Annals of Ulster, all of the Annals. The O'Cleary book, we had John Cleary speaking yesterday. This is also a very, very interesting thing. The problem is they're all lying in libraries. They haven't really been digitized or indexed. I think it would be a great project to collaborate with the genealogical societies of Ireland or with the history departments of the various universities and make an effort to get these digitized indexed, brought online, so that we can then start the work of trying to map some of our SNPs to these. I'll address those questions at the end, yeah? They could be digitized, indexed, and put into JETCON format. And this would be the idea. We know how to do mapping of the surnames associated with the individual SNPs, and then link them to the ancient genealogies. Maybe 50% of them are wrong. 50% of them will prove to be fake or invented or fabricated. Maybe 50% of them are true, right? So that's a major task to do. A couple of years, last year, we were at this level here in the phylogenetic tree. And this year, we got all of these new branches and SNPs to investigate. And there's still, this is only the top of the iceberg in terms of newly discovered SNPs. There's a lot more need to be positioned on the phylogenetic tree. So this gives us a very powerful tool in which to map onto the historic period, named individuals in the historic period. And this is how you would do it. You would map the terminal SNP to the ancient genealogy. And, so this is a little bit fanciful, so excuse it. My particular one is the Eli O'Carroll one here. You could imagine doing O'Sullivan Bear. This is the O'Brien one, the Conor O'Brien, the chief of the clan, and Lord Inchquin. He has tested with the latest NGS test. And we have his marker here, and it corresponds to the L226. We also have, in the case of the Stuarts, who everyone thought were a Brittany Norman family from whoever, but in fact have this DF41 marker, and the Earl of whoever, the largest landowner in Scotland, he has tested with the latest Big Y test. And it's proven we have found that particular signature, which identifies the Stuarts. We have the Dalrida, the Connacht, the Galloglass, the Gaelic, and the Kennel Tunnel. This is about 10. I think we would be happy if we got about 100 like this, and we would have a good, reasonable mapping of SNPs to genealogies. So this is what's happened in the last year or so. The inflection, these are only the markers which have been positioned on the phylogenetic tree, but it tells the same story that this was the year of inflection, and it's going to accelerate rather than increase. This is a quick mapping of surnames to particular terminal SNPs. And we see different names, the Burns and the Murphys grouping together, the O'Sullivans, the O'Donoghues, the Inukta. My particular favorite one is the Eli O'Carroll, somewhere in there, and so on and so forth. The Maddens and the Kellys, that's not surprising here, right? And the UCC are doing some great work in terms of mapping, doing very detailed townland level mapping to surnames. So again, this would be a great project to tie up with these people and link our SNP maps to the surname maps of Ireland and get an awful lot more analysis from that. This is some of the maps I produced myself for my own surname, and this goes down to townland level, and we've solved many of our genealogical mysteries. Once you plot it in this format, it becomes very, very clear what were the historical reasons for families moving from A to B and from B to A, etc. And one very, very interesting project is ancient DNA testing. The churches, abbeys, museums, cathedrals, private crypts in Ireland, they contain the remains of very famous people with famous genealogies. And there's one particular project, which is the Earls of Barrymore project. Earls of Barrymore, they owned Fota Island in Cork. They're a very wealthy family, Anglo-Norman family. One of the descendants of the Barrymore, he's a US professor. They've obtained permission to sample the remains. They're working with UCT Genetics Laboratory to do this project. I think they're just finalizing their funding, which is a very small amount of funding. They only need €1,000 or something. And it's all the rest of it is volunteer work. And that will be the first ancient DNA project in Ireland. Very, very exciting. And hopefully there will be many, many others like it. Of course, the famous one in the UK was King Richard III. One I would like to see happen is in Iona Abbey. There are 50 plus kings of Scotland, Ireland, Norway, all lying in unmarked graves from Kenneth MacAlpine to Macbeth to Malcolm III. All of their gravestones have eroded over time, so we don't know who's who. So at least in respect to them, it would be nice to identify them and give them proper markers for their burial. And it would certainly solve an awful lot of DNA puzzles that we have. So what's going to happen? I think Brad talked a little bit about what will happen in the future. So the evolution of genomics is much faster than the evolution of Moore's law. So the cost of genome sequencing is going down very quickly. And this is the economics of DNA sequencing. So the cost is dropping twice by a factor of two per year. The sequencing side is becoming commoditized. So the real bottleneck now is in informatics, right? In analytics and things like that. There's new technology which is coming. The DNA sequencer for full DNA sequencing is a room full of machines, right? Very large machines. The latest technology being produced is nanopore, which is the size of a memory stick here, right? And these are very portable. They are not yet ready for market. They're used by researchers. They cost researchers about $1,000 today, but they will sequence a full genome with very long read lengths. Unfortunately, the error rates are quite high at the moment. But for genealogy purposes, they could be quite useful. The Human Genome Project, 10 years ago, the first genome was sequenced to cost $3.7 billion. It took 10 years. Today, it can be done, a full genome for medical research can be done for $1,000. It takes a couple of hours. The ROI produced by the Human Genome Project, that means the industry it has given birth to and all of the companies it has spawned, has generated, about 968 billion of additional value, both in terms of agriculture, in healthcare, and so on and so forth. So it's a very, very large ROI. The ROI was 140,000%. My focus for the next year, the year 2015, will be in big data and analytics. I've been accepted into the IBM Watson program, and Watson is the largest supercomputer in the world, which has been used for genomics medical research up to now very effectively, and they're opening it up to a beta testing program for sort of citizen scientists. So I'll be working on that. And we also have a very interesting group in Ireland, which is all of the universities combined, or many of the universities combined, about 200 PhDs dedicated to big data analytics. So we'll be looking at applying some of that knowledge today. One more thing. We're finalizing the National Diaspora Centre. A decision will be made shortly. It'll either be in Dunleary or in the centre of Dublin. And we're waiting for a result of that. Regardless of where it's going to be, we will be supporting them, and we will be advocating that they have DNA testing there. Okay, a couple of case studies. These are just people I have matched on my DNA. These are Corcorans of Minnesota, related to me 7 generations ago. I invited them back last year for a gathering. They bought 20 people. We're all best friends now. I gave them their certificate of Irish heritage. And and this was another one. It was related to my maternal side. They emigrated to Australia. They ended up in San Francisco. He became the biggest architect in San Francisco. He built about 800 notable buildings. And we matched with his great-great-great-granddaughter. And now we're best friends. So that's basically a quick overview of some of the migration that happened. Thank
you. Well, Brother Rob, you've taken us from prehistory up to modern times in the space of an hour. So thanks very much, Gerard. It is getting late, but if there are any questions, we might have time for one or two questions or two comments. We have one here at the back from Kathy. I know, she's running out of the room, and I have your batteries in the microphone. Okay.
But just to say that perhaps the most interesting from your point of view is that Bart Yasky has put a lot of the 12th century genealogies up on PDF files.
Okay.
And they're available as transcripts. But the point I would make is that there's an editing process going on. So just like all your other disciplines, what goes up, what's in the books or what's in on a PDF file, there has been human, you know, processing of that.
Okay.
And it's not dispassionate data.
Okay.
But at least it is a transcript which may be of use.
That would be fantastic.
The other thing which is of use, I'll talk to Morris about some of the bibliographies. The www.ucc.ie Celt website.
Yeah.
It doesn't have much on genealogy, but it has all the annals up.
That's right.
And you can do a control find on those. So you can find people if you go to that website. That's the best collection of medieval material online.
Wonderful.
Okay?
Thank you very much indeed, Catherine.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Thanks, Kathy. Good luck. We'll talk soon. Take care. And any other comments as well? We have a lady down here at the front.
I've been looking forward to this all day. I've done my father's Y-DNA. Feeling quite frustrated, and I'm feeling even more isolated having listened to this. And what I had long suspected was that L or L21 was the Celtic or the Irish.
L21. Yeah,
L21, whereas we're L23 from the middle of Ireland, and I don't really know.
L23.
And we thought that it's quite unusual. I had a 12 marker match with a man from County Galway. We thought that we might be part of the HT35 grouping, but that proved false because we tested negative for Z2103.
Yes.
Now, again, I know you've mentioned that these SNP tests are becoming cheaper and cheaper, but unfortunately, they can actually mount up if you're you know, if you keep having to do them. So I was recommended to do P312, but you're saying that quite a large percentage of Irish people are P312 anyway. So should I skip that and go further down the line, would you suggest?
Yeah, no, I would, you know, you could take the general 2.0, which would get you down to below L21, right?
Okay.
Like you are several layers above it at the moment,
okay.
Right?
Okay.
And that's one option. The the main thing is to join the project, a surname project, and ask the administrator, because they will compare you with all of the other moduls in that particular project, and they will recommend further
testing.
I tend
to end up in the ungrouped section.
All right. Yeah, but it's also good to be an unusual one, because it could be very interesting for research. This could be the key piece of information which would indicate, you know, where a particular population was at a particular time.
The missing link, so
yes,
to speak.
Exactly. Yeah.
Well, there is some good news as well, because previously you'd have to do one of these big sequencing tests, like the Big Y, which costs $500, well, $495 in the sale, $695 normally. But the good news that they announced last week in Houston is that Family Tree DNA are actually taking just the OR snips, the snips associated with the OR haplogroup. And they're going to do a deep plate ore
test.
Right.
Yeah.
And that means that it'll be substantially less expensive. And the actual snips will work out at something between $1 and $1.50 per snip.
Instead of 39.
You will get about 100 snips, so it'll still be about $100 to do the test. But it's still substantially less than the $695 you'd have to pay for the Big Y. And it does mean that you get all the snips of your specific major haplogroup itself, rather than all the other ones that you're not interested in. So that'll be a way forward. You joined the haplogroup project for L23, right? Yes. And always keep in touch with the project admins and say, what would you recommend I do next? And they will give you very, very good advice on that. So it's worthwhile checking in with them from time to time, because it's a fast-moving field. If you wrote to them 6 months ago, write to them again and say, any news, any advice on what I should do now? Any other... yes, Brian, at the back, let me give you the microphone.
It's only my very quick realistic check, because I'm an L21, DF21, and all of my family, of course, lived in northeast Norfolk. You just need to be careful. You know, we get so biased on the Irish thing here, because there's so many people in America desperate to do whatever. And it's, again, you know, sampling across the UK, that big red lot that are sitting there too.
Yes. I agree, but my maps were only of Ireland. That was my particular interest. I should do maps of the Isles, of course. Yeah.
Next
version will be.
I think because Ireland and England were connected such a long time ago, we need a new name, really, for this kind of landmass on the edge of Europe. And I was thinking the Hibernian Peninsula.
Some people said Doggerland. Doggerland. Yeah.
Doggerland, yes. It doesn't have the same ring to it, really. But listen, that brings us to the end of a wonderful 3-day Genetic Genealogy Ireland 2014. I really have to thank Family Tree DNA for sponsoring the speakers area and sponsoring the conference, for sponsoring the stand downstairs and allowing us enthusiasts from ISOG to come and really just bring genetic genealogy to everybody. But not only that, but to have speakers, the caliber of Gerard and Michelle and all the other speakers that were here, coming and sharing their own wisdom and expertise and offering new opportunities for collaboration between different disciplines. So I think it's been an absolute wonderful 3 days. I've enjoyed it immensely myself. I've had the wonderful opportunity of staying here the whole time and listening to everything. So I consider myself very lucky. But I would also like to thank all of you, especially for some of you who have actually stayed here for all of the lectures. If we'd known that, we would have got you armchairs. So thank you very, very much for coming. And thank you to Michelle, to Gerard, to Debbie, to all the speakers.
It's almost worth mentioning that there was about 200 DNA kits that were
sold.
Collected.
We sold 200 DNA kits.
Wow.
Fantastic.
Twice as many.
Right.
Well
done. That deserves a round of applause. Thanks, everybody. Good night.
Let's thank Morris as well. running us out down the stairs.
When she speaks, you listen.